Boys and girls, we have with Labor Day approaching. Y'all had asked me what some recipes are, and I've got some sausages. I'll talk about them in a minute. But here's a cool recipe that I found for football, tailgating, that kind of thing. All that's coming up too. Get you some brats. Some hard apple cider. Some onions. Chop your onions up. Put your brats in some simmering water with the onions. And simmer your onions and brats in the hard apple cider until your brats measure about 145, somewhere in there, 140, 145, with an instant read thermometer. Remove them. Drain the cider out the pan. Keep the onions. Strain them out, okay? Put you some butter in the pan. How much? A good half a nut, about that much. A quarter of a stick. Put your onions back in there with some thyme, whole sprigs of thyme, like two of them, two little sprigs. Saute that down. And this is from a recipe that I found. What I would do, I'd put some garlic in there too. Saute that down. But before you do that, you know, you got your chimney charcoal lit, you pulled your brats out, wrap them with bacon, thin bacon, they had 140 to 145, you can use some toothpicks to pin the bacon in place, wrap it peppermint stick style, you know, kind of spiral it down, pin it, with, and then go grill them till the bacon is crisped up. Remove your the thyme sprigs out the pot, then you know, don't let your onions burn, but let them caramelize, because now they've got that cider flavor. Get your buns, whatever you're gonna put them on, some good mustard, brats, and eat. Potato chips, whatever you're gonna do. Now, let's talk about our sausage. I would never do that to it. Here's why. Very fortunately, I live in the South, and we've got some small chain grocers down here. There's just a handful of them, maybe three or four or five. And then there's some specialty meat shops here in town. And the first thing you notice when you walk in, they got a real wood smoker in here somewhere. You can smell it. And but they've got this wonderful, wonderful smoked sausage that they sell. This is real smoked sausage. This is an andouille made with jalapeno and cheese. Yum. We may cook a link of that also. Put it on a hunk of bread. It'd be a shame to put barbecue sauce on that. May have to, though. The bread would be kind of dry without it. Good barbecue sauce, though. I think I got some Coakley's in there. We'll use some of that. It's good. What else I was going to say? Yeah, most sausages you find that are mass-produced and sold nationwide, they may see smoke briefly, like less than 5 seconds, to kind of run them through the smoke and then go package them. Or they use liquid smoke. Which I guess if that's all you can get, the real stuff is a whole lot better. By the way, the poll, it looks like longer videos or however I want to make them wins. Thank y'all all for commenting and letting me know this. You want a shorter video? Oh well, sorry. Let's go on and expand on the sausage, for instance. If you want a really good smoky sausage, like what's kind of micro-managed, not micro-managed, made on a small scale down here in the South, at little mom and pop local meat markets and things like that, unless you make it yourself with a smoker, and normally sausage is low temperature smoked like bacon. If you see a bacon that says real hardwood smoked, is it really? It's got to be smoked at a low temperature, like 90 degrees. You can't let it start cooking, or it'll be cooked. So they may be actually using liquid smoke, which was made or distilled from smoke, kind of like alcohol is distilled, but from smoke, and it makes this liquid. The problem with it is most people, when they get it, they use too much, and it'll make whatever you put it in bitter. Just like if you put too much wood when you're smoking meat, you can make it bitter. So bacon is normally injected with a smoke brine solution, cured like that. If you see a bacon that says sugar cured, okay, well, it's sugar cured. How do you smoke sugar? I don't know about that. Let's not get into that. If you want a good smoked sausage, go buy what you can get. If it's mass produced, like X brand, YZ brand, and smoke it yourself on your smoker, you know, finish it on your smoker with some real wood, and you'll have something similar to what we have down here. It may not have as much garlic in it. You may not can get the varieties that we have, like jalapeno cheese or green onion or extra garlic or stuff like that we like. Now you know about that. While we're on bacon, let's touch on this. A picnic shoulder roast. If you see them in your grocery stores, it's like the leg of a pig or a shoulder section, shank section of the up in here. That part. What ham is made from normally, but this is uncured, it's raw. You'll see some skin on the outside of it. That's what pork belly is. No, I'm sorry. Let me regroup. You see that skin on the outside of it. When they make bacon, they use what's known as pork belly, and it's got skin on it. That's trimmed off before it's smoked and cured and whatever they're going to do with the rest of the pork belly. Well, that skin section is what's sold to processors like Rudolph Foods, who make those pellets for cracklings and pigskins. And that's, you know, y'all seen my videos on that too. We're not gonna make those today. Probably not gonna make a sausage po' boy today. It's raining, number one. I ain't going outside in the rain and reheat my sausage on a grill, which is the best way to do it. You could pan fry it, or you could put it in some beans, that really good smoked sausage. Oh yeah. But I had beans last night. I didn't make a video, sorry. Now let's move on. Cut. Picnic shoulder roast. It's still got some of that skin on it too, that you can trim off and dry it and make you some cracklings with, or pig skins with. You gotta cut it off though. And it's gotta be dried. Or dehydrated, number one. Normally you would season it and then you deep fry it after it's been processed like that. I forgot to add that, so I'm adding it now, boy. Son of a bitch. Let me go get another pop before I continue. or we're gonna get into cornbread. Ice in it. Kind of freeze my jaw. Now I can't talk right. My tongue all frozen.
No, it ain't.
Cornbread. Why? It's sugar in some people's cornbread, and why do you think it's supposed to be sweet? In the 1800s and forever, Southerners never put sugar in their cornbread. In recent years, sugar has been added to it to try to make it taste like it used to back when it was milled with a water-powered stone grits mill. Okay, and I've got some show and tell down here for you people. Let's go over this and then we'll go to the show and tell. Number one, flour and sugar got no place in cornbread, southern cornbread. It's been added here recently to what you'll find in stores. Your cornmeal mixes and such as that. Let's see here. Cornbread's been a staple diet, you know, in the South for since the 1800s. And you know, you'd very see Southerners eating biscuits, except on special occasions, because wheat wasn't really, it didn't survive well in our climate with the high humidity and the water in the soil, and more or less rust in the fields and wither and die and stuff. It just didn't do well. In the beginning, cornbread was basically corn pone, and later it made its way into being real cornbread. But even with corn pone, it wasn't sweet. It you would maybe pour some syrup on it after it had been cooked, but it really hadn't risen until later on when they first discovered to add a little bit of buttermilk or baking soda to help it rise. Okay, later eggs and baking powder made their ways into recipes. But two ingredients you'll never see in any recipe before the 20th century are wheat flour and sugar. Let's see if I need to mention this or not. In 1892, a news reporter reported that many types of corn-based breads are eaten in Virginia. And he observed that none of them had sugar in them. They had corn puddings and things like that, and they would add maybe a maple syrup to it or something sweet to it after the fact, to top it with, in other words. In 1937, a reporter noted that in Kentucky, cornbread was made with white cornmeal. Never any sugar yet was added, and it was all the cornmeal was ground with stone on a stone style mill. You better be recording, you non-union camera. Good, batteries are hot too. Pop time. Had to knock the ice off the top. Let's see, where we at? Unlike stone mills, the newer style mills that they went to later on were steel roller mills. And the problem with those is it eliminated a lot of the corn kernel and germ. In doing so, it made the cornmeal more shelf stable, but it robbed a lot of the flavor, the sweetness and flavor out of the cornmeal. And the friction of the steel rolling wheels or whatever they use in the rollers generate a lot of heat too. And it further eroded the flavor of the cornmeal, right? But one of the most important factors is the high pressure steel wheels reduce the size of the kernel, the meal itself. And the smaller meal wouldn't rise. The smaller grain of corn didn't rise like the larger grain. It wouldn't leaven correctly. That's why they had to start adding other things to help it leaven, rise, like baking powders, buttermilks, and things like that. And it also didn't taste the same because there wasn't no sugar in it. So maybe your grandma added sugar to hers because she couldn't get the old stone ground stuff anymore. The old water wheel powered stone grits mills slowly faded away, and all they had was this store-bought stuff that didn't have the flavor the old stuff had. It wasn't naturally sweet, in other words. Let's see, is the cornmeal texture changed? Yeah, the particle size required to react with chemical leavenings didn't work no more because blah, blah, blah. I can cut this part out. The change from stone to steel milling is likely what prompted cooks to start putting sugar in cornbread. In the old days, the Southerners ground our corn from varieties known as dent, D-E-N-T corn. And it was also left in the fields to dry out by itself. And when it was milled, since it had been field ripened, it was completely dry. Today, what they're doing when they steel rolling it is they're buying fresh corn, air drying it with heat, and that takes your sugar out. It kills it. The high volume steel millers, forced air drying, and you're putting sugar in it because the sugar content is lower. Because they're not using the dent corn, they're not using the silver queen corn that we had naturally sweet. That's a white corn. They make a yellow sweet corn too, the dent corn. But there's also other varieties of corn that are not that sweet, and that's what a lot of people use. And we'll show you some in a little bit. There are some other people. Let's see, that are still using the heirloom quality or heirloom varieties of dent to return the old flavor of sweetness to cornmeal and grits too. Anniston Mills Antebellum Coarse White Cornmeal uses the old variety. So does Big Bob's Mill brand. And you can find these at stores. It's going to be a little hard to find. And you won't have any need to add sugar. I covered that pretty well. Here's Aunt Jemima's cornmeal. Let's get down here closely. And then I'll get some stills really close up. Look at how fine, here's an ink pen. Look at how fine this is milled down. Okay? This is stone ground. Look at the size of the kernels. You see in there? This is the good stuff. Now you got to keep this refrigerated because it's got germ in it. Look, de-germinated, de-flavored. That's what that means. Here's some. Now this is straight cornmeal. Got nothing else in it. This do. It got wheat flour. It probably got baking soda in it. Look how fine it is. It's like flour almost. See your differences?
Yeah, it probably got powdered buttermilk in it too, and that ain't gonna help me out none. Give me the good shit right here. See the differences? Let's spread that around and get some close-ups. A boy. You don't need no sugar if you got this. And this tastes like real corn. That don't. You gotta add flavorings to these two. Not that. A little butter. Yum. You want it sweet? Pour some syrup on it.
And they're gonna be in the following order. Left to right will be the first. Left will be first, which is gonna be the Aunt Jemima corn, plain cornmeal. And then the Bob's Red Mill stone ground. You plainly see the difference. The camera's at the same distance from the shot in each one. Martha White's cornmeal mix, a cornbread mix. Look, corn. Oh, is that what it looked like? That's barreled corn with crawdads. Stone ground grits. Yep. Yum. We use it on everything. We're going to abbreviate Cajun smoked sausage, CSS. This was the bomb. A yum. Yeah. We loves our sausages, grits. Yep. It's great in gumbo, especially the smoked variety. Italian meatballs and gravy. Po' boys. Which smoked sausages and good mustard. Oh, smoked boudin. You knew I had to throw that in here. Boy, I bet y'all wished y'all lived down to Bayou, huh? Down to Bayou, yep. Next door to JB.
Now, if you ain't learned nothing from that, just stay stupid. Just try not to die stupid. That's a bad thing. Bye.
Don't that pretty. Ooh, boy. Yum.